Hi, I'm Dr. Good from the Virginia Spine Institute. I'm going to be sharing with you some details about a really common condition, but a little bit of an unusual story about a patient of mine, Paula, and the path that she went through to get feeling good again. So first I'm going to just start by showing one of Paula's x-rays. This is a side view of Paula's back. This is somebody I've taken care of for quite some time. What we see here is a side view showing the bones and the discs of the spine, which are stacked one on top of another. Now, the discs are the cushions of the spine, the space in between the bones. And we move through each one of these levels just like cars attached on a roller coaster, and that gives us the flexibility of our spine. Now, we can see a normal disc is a nice space between the bones, and many of us will have degeneration of our discs throughout the years, where the disc may crack and tear and wear away, and over time, the bones are no longer cushioned properly and they come together. And so that's what this looks like here. Okay, so this is a common part of human life. Some people who get this don't even feel anything, but other people, as this happens, it can take away the cushion, leading to bone-on-bone type of changes and triggering back pain. Another thing that can happen, the nerves of the back come out in this space right here. So the nerves come out of the spine and they run down your leg like a little electrical cable. And so if a disc goes bad and the bones come together, that can narrow the space where the nerve comes out. So you can see the space here where a normal nerve space would be versus here. And some people, as this happens, will get compression or pinching of the nerves in the back, which can cause sciatica or pain, numbness, and weakness going down the leg. And so at this point, based on the symptoms Paul was having, we discussed the potential for a surgery procedure. And what we discussed ultimately was a surgery to go in the front of the spine, so the abdomen is up here, and actually go in and clean out the disc and put in a shim or a cage that distracts the bones apart. Now that's a fusion procedure. The benefit for the fusion procedure is it takes away this rubbing and this friction. So if you have a lot of back pain, that can be very helpful with that. Also, by moving the bones apart, it can open up the space for nerves. So if people have pinched nerves in this scenario, that can be another really great way to open up the space around their nerves, taking away sciatica pain or numbness or weakness, those kind of neurologic problems down in the leg. Now, this is another type of picture. This is an MRI scan of Paula's back. And so now we're still looking at a side view, but we can see a higher resolution type of picture that we can see on an MRI. And so this white, that's the bone. And so these bones are like blocks stacked one on top of another. These are the discs, the healthy cushions in between. And we can see what a nice healthy disc looks like. In comparison, if a disc degenerates away, we can see that on the MRI scan. There's no space left in between the bones here. And we can see there's gone on to be some disc herniation taking place here as well. And so again, the surgical procedure is meant to go in, push the bones apart, open up the space around the nerves to take care of this problem. Now, ultimately, Paula did have the surgery done. She actually had this done with a different surgeon for a variety of reasons. When they went in and do the procedure, we can see they actually put a cage which goes in between the bones. And so the point of that is to go in and distract the bones apart. If we look at what that looks like on this model, so this is just a plastic model showing, we can actually see in this case the bones are clear. In the real patient, they're not actually clear, but we can see a metallic cage, which is like the one the surgeon used in this scenario. And this cage is full of bone graft, which ultimately welds or fuses these bones together, taking away the movement. Now, unfortunately, when the surgery took place, there were some challenges, and the surgeons had some trouble with the nerves, and so they weren't able to get everything taken care of that they wanted to. And so actually quite a bit of time went by where Paula continued to have really horrible nerve pain and weakness and numbness and couldn't straighten her leg and had to use a walker. And so really kind of a really challenging and kind of heart-wrenching story about what she had to get through to ultimately try and get feeling better. Unfortunately, despite everything she tried, she just really couldn't get feeling better. And that was actually when she came back to see me again so we could try and figure out if there was anything else that could be done for her. And so that's always a really challenging situation. If someone is in has a situation where they do a surgery, they don't get the results that they had wanted for one reason or another, and then we're trying to figure out, what's the explanation? What else can be done to kind of try and save the day and get things moving back in the right direction? And so that we obviously had some concern, but part of what we did in terms of trying to get Paula feeling better was to consider an additional surgery to go in the opposite side of the spine. So instead of going in the abdomen, actually going in the back part of the spine and doing some additional surgery to work around the nerves again and open up space around the nerves. And at this point, she was having really major nerve damage and weakness and numbness. And this is somebody who, before all these spine problems happened, was running long distances and exercising and riding the bike and, like, you know, super healthy lifestyle. And so to be at the point where even kind of getting out of bed and walking without a walker is impossible, that's, you know, really unacceptable. And so luckily, despite the challenges, we were able to go in and we were able to shave some additional space around the nerves on the other side and opening up space for the nerves. And that surgical procedure luckily was able to get her a really tremendous improvement. And so we didn't actually change the cage that was put in. We actually went in and did additional work from the other side and opened up space for the nerves. And that got her over the edge. Instead of being totally miserable, she started to be able to straighten her leg again, move her muscles again. As time went on, she got a lot of recovery, but had some just ongoing nerve problems. It was really kind of felt like permanent nerve damage just from everything the nerve had been going through during this whole year of these problems. We did lots of physical therapy and lots of things to strengthen the nerve. And ultimately, she made a lot of progress with the surgery that we did, but we decided to go forward with one additional procedure. And what we actually did was put a needle into her pelvis bone, her hip bone here, sucking out some bone marrow. And it's a little hard to see on the picture, but if we look, the nerves in the back run in this area. And what we did is we put a small needle in the hole at the very base where the nerves are, and we took some concentrated bone marrow, which is, people call it stem cells, but it's really very concentrated growth factors that come from your own body. And so we actually injected those through a small needle. So those go up into this area, coating this area in your own growth factors. And the goal of that was to try and further calm down the inflammation and stimulate really kind of a natural healing response from the body. And so thankfully, by doing that, we were able to get over the hump the rest of the way. So we got a lot of great improvement by some additional surgery to open up the space around the nerves. But then by even having one more tool in the toolbox and being able to inject these growth factors, we were able to get the nerve symptoms to calm down even further. And so thank God at this point, I just saw Paula today. I asked her if she was running and she said, really, no. Well, I do a 5K from time to time. And so it was awesome. Like, we were laughing that you know, someone who runs so much that, like, doing a 5K doesn't even count as running. But back, you know, riding motorcycles across country, Peloton, you know, kind of, you know, crushing it in life again. And so super awesome to see this kind of success. And I think there's a lot of lessons, there. You know, one, perseverance, I think, is just a lesson for all of us in life, right? If you keep working on it and keep coming at things from a different direction, lots of times you're able to find a way through. Obviously, if anyone is considering surgery, or whenever we're considering surgery, doing everything we can to get it right the first time, do the right surgery, the one that's most likely to be successful and definitive the first time around, to me, is always something I'm really trying to achieve. And even though the first one didn't go as well as she would have liked, sticking with it, and having the guts to ultimately learn about other alternatives and try some other things, and ultimately we're able to help her get through on the other side. And so it's a really great story of combining not only lots of hard work and physical therapy and surgery, but also a regenerative medicine procedure using stem cells from her own hip, all to help her achieve her highest potential. And I think it's been 3 years today from this procedure that was first performed, and now she's back doing all the things she loves to do. So congratulations, super exciting.